Can I welcome you to the 26th meeting in 2015 of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. Everyone present is reminded to switch off mobile phones as they affect the broadcasting system. As meeting papers are provided in digital format, you may see tablets being used during the meeting. Apologies for absence have been received from Siobhan McMahon. Agenda item number one is the Scottish Housing Regulator. The committee will take oral evidence on the Scottish Housing Regulator's annual report and accounts for 2014-15 from Kay Blair, Chair, and Michael Cameron, Chief Executive of the Scottish Housing Regulator. Good morning. Can I welcome Kay and Michael and invite Kay Blair to make a short opening statement?
Thank you very much, Convener. And thank you, Committee, for giving us this opportunity to present our annual report for 2014-15 and an update on our work since we last met in June. I'm pleased to report that in the year under review, we achieved all of our objectives on time, to budget, with just over 50 dedicated members of staff and with good tenant outcomes as a result. Again, it was a very challenging but good year. Obviously, we'll answer any questions that you have at the end of this short opening statement. I'd like to start by talking about the engagement we have with the customers of social housing and how it impacts on our regulation. In 2014-15, we used direct feedback from tenants to shape the focus of our work. In particular, we co-produced with tenants the landlord charter reports, which I hope many of you will have seen. We used tenant feedback to direct the focus of our national analysis. And we set out our programme of thematic work around the areas that customers of social housing told us matter most. It's very important for us as a regulator that we listen to all of our stakeholders. In August this year, we published the second year of information from landlords on their charter performance. We provided tenants, amongst others, with even better information on how their own particular landlord is performing, including 2 years of comparison information. Our analysis shows that in general, landlords are delivering modest improvements across almost all of the indicators, and most encouragingly, it is those landlords with the most room for improvement that have actually improved the most, and that is particularly what we wanted to see. We'll publish our next full national analysis early in 2016, and I hope members of the committee will all be able to attend our launch event of that report in February. I believe invitations have already gone out to you, so hopefully they're in your email box somewhere. I also hope that you've had the chance to use our comparison tool to look at the performance of particular landlords you might be interested in. We received very positive feedback on tenants on how empowering this is, and we're pleased that other organisations are also using the data we publish to analyse and, most importantly, benchmark landlords' performance. Last month, and I hope again many of you will have seen this, we published the report on our national thematic inquiry into gypsy travellers. We presented this to your colleagues in the Equal Opportunities Committee, and we will be happy to tell you more about it later on in the session. After concluding our annual regulatory risk assessment in March, we published new regulation plans for 65 RSLs. We update these plans throughout the year to reflect our engagement. We also contributed to the local scrutiny plans published by Audit Scotland and set out our scrutiny in 23 councils. This June, we published information on how we assess risk, and in November, we published information on the risks and issues and challenges that we will consider in our next annual risk assessment of all social landlords. We have listened and responded to our stakeholders' feedback and where and how we can be even more transparent. I would like to highlight in particular our publication series, How We Work, explaining what we do, how we do it, and using very plain English to help with clarity. We also highlighted our discussion paper approach to developing our appeals proposals. This was a new innovation for us to actually issue a discussion paper before the consultation. It was very helpful because we had huge and constructive engagement with all sorts of stakeholders, including tenants, landlords and funders. I would also like to highlight a very important area of our work, which is our ongoing dialogue with lenders throughout the UK to help maintain confidence in this key sector. This is a key part of our work to make sure that lenders are on board, understand the sector and understand the risks. We're streamlining our regulatory requirements from landlords. This is something that we always said we were keen to do. We appreciate that regulation has a cost and we're keen wherever possible to make it simpler, more effective and to streamline it. And we've also hosted very productive roundtable discussions on value for money in the sector and also risk issues and opportunities in the sector. We've continued our statutory action in two RSLs, Wellhouse and Muirhouse. I would encourage you to read the recent published regulation plans for these organisations, which explain our current engagement. Good progress has been made by both landlords, and yesterday we ended the statutory appointment of the special manager at Muirhouse. We will continue to support both landlords as they put right what had gone wrong in their organisations and make further improvements. We will go live with our new appeals process in April 2016. As I said, we worked with our stakeholders during September and October, and this early discussion with interested parties has allowed us to issue a consultation document that already captures many of our stakeholders' views. Formal consultation on our proposals will run until January. We remain committed to an appeals mechanism that is transparent, that is accessible, proportionate and cost-effective, and that is also balanced with the need for us to act swiftly where necessary to protect the interests of tenants and others. You may recall we had a very interesting discussion in June about the interest savings that our effective regulation ensures. I explored this further with the lenders afterwards and reported back to you that lenders estimate our value in terms of savings and interest rate charges between £30 to £80 million per year. If we use a conservative estimate of £40 million, that would be 10 times our current annual budget and is the equivalent to 40% of the sector's net surplus and provides sufficient equity to allow RSLs to build around 800 new homes each year. I'll be very pleased, convener, to provide more information on any of those areas or others that you might wish today to discuss. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, Ms. Blair. And perhaps I can kick off our session and ask you to update the committee on how you've been improving communications with stakeholders.
Absolutely. Communications is very dear to our heart, and we've always said that we're a listening organisation, that we want to take on board feedback and we want to help us improve our own standards. So we have a continued and increased focus in our work on our language, on our tone, on our transparency and our effectiveness. We've published, as I said, an information guide on how we work and how we assess risk. And basically more information about how we operate so that all understand what we do and how we do it. In July, we published an update on governance matters, which was a very positive document, again highlighting issues where things had gone wrong, but also highlighting how they had been addressed and how they were delivering better outcomes. And I have to say personally that I get huge positive constructive feedback from the stakeholders that I meet about the value of these publications and how they use things like performance matters and governance matters to just check how their own organisations are doing and what lessons they might learn from these case studies and what tools they might use to put things right in their own organisation. So I think in terms of transparency, there's been, convener, a huge focus on this, on communications and effective communications. And I think we are getting much more positive feedback about tone, content, etc.
Okay, you said in your reply that you have a particular focus on language and tone and that you have overall received positive feedback from stakeholders, but one of the stakeholders, the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations, has suggested that in their view there is still a negative tone in some of the regulators' publications, such as the Governance Matters publication that you mentioned, and that good practice should be highlighted more. Do you have any sympathy with that assessment, and is this something that you are continuing to work to improve?
I'm always keen to listen to feedback, and obviously we will be discussing this further with the SFHA, but I'm actually very disappointed by their comments, because I think we've put huge focus behind our work. I think the latest Governance Matters was a very positive publication, and personally I say I've had hugely constructive feedback about it. So I will take it on board, but I am disappointed, and I do think that an organisation like SFHA could also join us perhaps in doing more in sharing good practice across the sector, in encouraging good leadership across the sector, and obviously we discuss these issues with them and areas where we might both improve further.
I mean, you have regular meetings with the SFHA at quite a high strategic level. Are you surprised that there still seems to be this gap in understanding between the two organisations?
I am surprised, and it's something obviously I will raise with them. I think it is disappointing, and perhaps I would point them to go back and look at our July publication again to see whether it does accurately reflect their views.
Okay, I don't want to add to your disappointment, but another stakeholder, the Glasgow and West of Scotland Forum of Housing Associations, have highlighted their concerns that they believe, and this is perhaps a more serious concern, that much harsher language is used to describe the charter performance of housing associations, even though in their view their performance is significantly better than that of local authorities. And in fact, their evidence to this committee makes that point quite extensively. They say the obvious consequence of such an approach is a sense that levels of genuine risk can be exaggerated in order to amass the desired number of regulation plans issued each year. There's a distinct feeling among many GWSF members that this is the case. Could you respond to those concerns?
Yes, and again, I will listen to this feedback, and we will discuss it with the forum. But again, I'm disappointed by the response. I think that we are not less critical of councils, but the local authority approach is also a reflection of our shared risk assessment with our other scrutiny partners. I think we still have the same exacting standards across the board as we seek continuous improvement in all RSLs and as we seek to raise standards further in the sector. I think the forum clearly wants to promote the good achievements of many of its members, but we as a regulator are not in a competition between RSLs and local authorities. We are keen to ensure the impact of our work in improving outcomes, and are particularly pleased that this year those with the most to improve on generally showed good results. Could I, Convener, perhaps ask my colleague Michael to add to this?
I think to add to the issue of the potential differences in language, we reviewed the paper that the forum produced. I think our analysis of that paper would be that it was relatively selective in what it looked at. It considered just two RSLs and a small number of councils by way of comparison. As Kay has indicated, there are differences in the final products that are produced. One is exclusively produced by the Scottish Housing Regulator. The other is a collaboration with other scrutiny bodies. We will, of course, continue to look at the language we use to ensure that it's appropriate language and that it's consistent where it should be consistent.
Field in the way in which the regulator approaches the regulation of councils as against housing associations?
Absolutely. We apply the exact same risk assessment methodology across councils and RSLs in relation to the Scottish Social Housing Charter.
That's clearly not the view of the Glasgow and West of Scotland Forum of Housing Associations, as they say in their evidence to this committee. The evidence so far is that the SHR adopts fundamentally different approaches to the assessment of charter performance across the two sectors.
Well, if I could perhaps point to evidence, and the evidence is that we engage directly with only a third of all registered social landlords. At the moment, we are engaging directly with 23 out of the 32 local authorities. That reflects the reality of the nature of our risk assessment, and that's the evidence outcomes from that risk assessment.
So you believe there's a level playing field, there's consistency in your approach and in your assessment of charter performance across both sectors.
There yes.
are no serious areas for improvement then?
There's areas for improvement in terms of landlord's performance against the charter. Absolutely there are. We will have a consistent approach to our assessment of risk in relation to the charter this year, as we have done last year. In November, we published the basis on which we will undertake that risk assessment, the key areas we will focus on. It sets out very clearly how we will go about that risk assessment in relation to both RSLs and local authorities.
Okay, I think we'll leave it there. Moving on to the appeals process, Ms Blair, you said that the appeals process is on track to be launched in April 2016.
Yes.
Can you update the committee with details of the work you've been undertaking to develop this appeals mechanism, and what are the main aspects of the,
yes,
the proposed structure and
yes,
process?
Indeed. As I said before, we took a novel approach for us in terms of having a discussion paper, first of all, and we engaged with all our stakeholders, with tenant organisations, with SFHA, with the forum, to make sure that we understood their perspective and that we could take their views into account. We're very keen in any appeals process to be transparent, to be accessible, to be proportionate and cost effective. We need to strike the right balance so that we ensure we're still effective as a regulator. Appeals cannot compromise our ability to use evidence-based judgment to make regulatory decisions, nor hamper our ability to intervene should tenants' interests be compromised. We are also aware of how keen lenders are to make sure we can act appropriately and effectively so that they can maintain their confidence. In terms of the discussion and consultation, we've proposed a two-stage process. So there will be an informal review process where anybody can approach us for an informal review. And then there will be a much more formal appeals process, looking at how far we can possibly go within the current legislation. We've engaged extensively, we've issued this discussion paper, and at the moment the consultation paper, which ends in January. I'm sure there will be different views, but we think that we've got the right balance in this appeals process, that we are being transparent. We're also very much looking at independent input into this and to see how we can do that, which is really important for an appeals process. But obviously we are bound by the legislation in terms of what we can do.
For that, you say that you're looking to have independent input into the process, but the final decision of the appeal would be for the board members to make. And of course, the SFHA have said that for the appeal to be truly independent of the regulator, legislative change would be required. Do you have a view on that?
That is something.
Apart from the statement of the obvious.
Yes, it's not within our powers. It would have to we'd have to go back to legislation, and it would be up to government.
Do you have a view on whether or not the legislation should be changed in order to make the appeals process more independent of the regulator?
I think what we have proposed is a good balance, and I think it should be given time to work, and we should evaluate its effectiveness, but I think it will be a good process and it will have independent input.
Okay, and the SFHA and the GWSF have indicated that they feel the scope of the appeals mechanism should be broadened to include regulation plans and some of the non-statutory recommendations made by the regulator to RSLs. Do you have a view on that?
Yes, we do. Michael, would you like to comment on that?
Yes, I think what's important is that there is proportionality in the appeals process. It's important to remember that the regulation plans are a statement of our regulatory judgment and also a statement of the engagement that we're going to have. Where any of the engagement that we're going to have falls within the parameters of the appeal process, then obviously that engagement would be appealable by the particular landlord. The regulation plans themselves will be subject to the review process that we've set out as the first stage in the appeal framework. So we think that that's a reasonable balance and a proportionate approach to take.
I'm going to move on. I'm going to ask Mike McKenzie to ask some questions.
Thank you, Convener. The area I wanted to explore first was about the concerning the model entitlements, payments and benefits policy. And I know with pleasure some progress has been made since our last meeting of the committee. So I'm, you know, absolutely welcome that. But also I'm concerned, and you'll understand my concerns given that I represent the Islands and Islands, that there are continuing problems in rural areas. And I wondered, you know, if you can see a way forward to ease the concerns of rural housing associations, their members and employees.
We were pleased to endorse the model policy that was produced by the SFHA, and we think it provides a good policy framework for those landlords to adopt, and it also includes a level of flexibility for individual landlords within that. We have been clear that where a landlord adopts the model policy and applies that model policy in practice, they should have confidence that it would be able to comply with regulatory standards. Of course, it is open to any landlord to adopt the policy with appropriate amendments or to adopt an entirely different policy that they feel is appropriate to their circumstances. And we made this clear to all landlords, emphasising the flexibility that those landlords have. That lets them ensure that the policy is appropriate to their local circumstances. It is, of course, the responsibility of each RSL to then ensure that whatever policy they do adopt enables them to comply with regulatory standards. So we will not routinely engage with landlords on their policy choices in that regard. That's a matter for them. And we will only engage with landlords in this area if we have concerns or become aware of actual improper or potentially improper conduct in this regard.
Yeah. Do you, and that's all very reassuring, but do you accept the nature of the problem in rural areas, and can you offer any guidance for rural housing associations in terms of how they ought to deal with the problem? Do you understand the problem, and can you offer any wisdom as to how they might best deal with it?
We always have, and from the outset we were very clear that we felt there was a need for flexibility, particularly in rural and island communities, and we were keen to ensure that that was built in to any model policy that was developed. We have always been clear that to take a comply and explain approach gives flexibility to individual landlords to take account of those local circumstances. And that's what we would encourage landlords to do, to ensure that their approach to the policy and the adoption of the policy is such that it gives them the necessary flexibilities to take account of their local circumstances, and that they are therefore able to demonstrate that by applying the policy they adopt, that enables them to achieve regulatory standards.
Yeah, okay. If I can I just paint a real-life scenario for you and ask how you would react to that? Assuming that I was a member or an employee of a housing association and you received a complaint, and the complaint centred about my use of a contractor to build, say, an extension to my home, and a contractor that also worked for the housing association. And let me say that, you know, just as any normal person would, I'd engaged an architect to design the extension, and he'd got attained planning consent and a building warrant, and then I asked him to put it out to tender for me. And three contractors tendered, and the one that I chose happened to be £10,000 cheaper than the other two. But that contractor also worked for the housing association. with which I was associated, and a complaint was made to you on the basis that I used that contractor. How would you deal with that scenario?
Well, I think in the first instance, what we'd do is we'd ask the association itself to look at the situation and to satisfy itself that there was no conflict of interest and that its own policies and procedures weren't compromised in terms of those circumstances. So that would be our first response. And then depending on what came out of that, we'd then determine whether there was any further need for us to engage with that association.
But would you accept that the situation I've described is part and parcel of the nature of the problem, and that as a regulator that you might be expected to be in a position to give very clear guidance for housing associations faced with this kind of predicament and how they deal with that kind of situation?
Well, the objective of the model policy is to give associations a framework within which they can manage those very types of situations. And I think the framework gives a level of guidance in those circumstances. Very often the circumstances are particular very particular and individual, and therefore it's difficult to be absolutely definitive. In those circumstances you describe, for example, it would maybe depend very much on the level of seniority of the officer, how involved that officer may have been in the appointment of the contractor, the award of work to the contractor. So there are many factors that would have to be taken account in determining whether it presented a significant conflict of interest, and therefore a conflict that needed to be managed in a particular way by the landlord itself. But I think it's about ensuring that there is flexibility to deal with the individual circumstances in a way that still protects the reputation of the landlord.
I understand the generality of your language, but you'll forgive me, Convener, if I say that I'm still as confused as I was at the start as to how housing associations should take the right decision with respect to the type of situation that I described. So I'm no wiser, but I'll move on to my next area of questioning.
Why matters for Mr. McKenzie?
I think it's difficult looking at general scenarios. I think there can be a lot of complexity and subtlety in this. And as I say, depending on exactly who the individual is, their nature of engagement with the contractor through the association would go a long way to determining whether there was a substantial conflict of interest. But as we've always said, we feel that there needs to be sufficient flexibility to enable landlords, particularly in rural and island areas where there may be a very limited market to access for staff and governing body members. There has to be a degree of flexibility in there. So it's about ensuring that flexibility while continuing to manage appropriately the conflicts of interest that can arise.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I'm out with the committee. I think I'll engage further with Mr. Cameron and Ms. Blair to see if we can...
I could just add one thing in that the SFHA have agreed that they will let this model policy run for a year, and then they will look at it and review it and evaluate its effectiveness and look at areas or potential areas to strengthen. So they will be discussing that with us after this year's progress.
Yeah, and I accept that's perfectly reasonable.
Yeah.
Perfectly reasonable, and I did note at the start that some progress has been made. What I'm putting to you is that there are remaining issues of which you're aware, and I would hope that as a regulator you'd be able to provide some clear guidance, even using some case study guidance, if you like, so that would help housing associations to guide them in this admittedly tricky area.
Yeah.
So, but I'll move on, I think, to my next question. I don't want to take up undue time with that issue. How do you respond to the concerns raised by the GWSF around the high costs housing associations can face in dealing with the consequences of regulatory engagements? And what steps, and this again was an issue that came up at our previous meeting, are you taking to increase the pool of Scottish-based consultants? Because when I look at the, what it is that housing associations do, they build houses, they rent them out, it's hardly rocket science. And it just, I just cannot understand why there shouldn't be a reasonable pool of suitable consultants within Scotland to deal with the issues that you're asking them to deal with.
I think that's a very relevant question, and I think it's something that we've been looking at. We're very aware that when special managers go into an organisation, that it is a cost. But it is a cost because there is a need for expertise and there is a need for certain skills. We are very keen to see if we can widen the base of those that are used. And we are just in the middle of setting up a selection panel, which we will make publicly available, which will show contractors how they work, how they charge, and be open for others to use. But we're very keen as well that we get the right skills and expertise to do what are, you know, quite complex jobs at times. I know it's quite a simplistic business model, but there is increasing complexity in most housing associations. Michael, do you want to add anything on that?
Yeah, I mean, I think to say on the cost, we will obviously always work to minimise any cost impact of statutory intervention. But there is, as somebody involved in one of the two organisations concerned put it, you know, there is a cost of putting things right. And a key consideration when we're appointing a special manager is to ensure that we regain the confidence of lenders in those organisations. And that goes a long way to help prevent the imposition of potentially huge costs on the association that could arise from a lender deciding to reprice. Preventing repricing can often very quickly repay the costs of any intervention, and over the lifetime of a typical loan could save the organisation millions. So I think that one-off investment in competent management and effective governance can avoid massive future costs, and that has to be borne in mind. I think it's also worth bearing in mind that there is the potential for us to use other statutory powers that are perhaps more draconian but would come at less cost, such as a more immediate transfer of engagements to another housing association. And certainly in terms of the work we're doing in the two statutory interventions at the moment, we will do a full lessons learned at the conclusion of those engagements. And one of the things we'll be looking at is whether there were more cost-effective ways for us to achieve the desired outcome of protecting the interests of tenants.
Yeah, thank you, but I mean, I don't feel that you're quite addressing the nub of my question. And the nub of my question is that surely we have the expertise, both the financial and the contracting, house building, house management expertise in Scotland. It beggars belief that we don't have that required expertise in Scotland, and therefore why you seem to have to go forth of Scotland in order to find people with that relevant expertise. I accept that there are always going to be costs involved. I accept that these interventions and the helpful assistance provided by consultants can help save future costs. What I'm struggling to accept is that there is nobody or very few people in Scotland capable of providing the kind of consultancy guidance that you seek to provide for housing associations that need that help. Why on earth is it?
Well, the exercise that we will be doing around establishing a selection panel will be open to all potential special managers, regardless of their nationality or their base. So there is the hopefully the potential that will indeed increase the number of people who may be Scottish based. It's not our objective though to target one particular nationality. You'll appreciate what we're doing is we're conducting this exercise to ensure that we have a panel of appropriately skilled and experienced people to draw on.
Do you think that perhaps the expertise does exist in Scotland, but for some reason they're reluctant to get involved? Is that potentially the problem?
We have used people who are Scottish based, and there are people who do that, there are people who associations use in terms of improvements to governance, financial management that are Scottish based. in relation to special managers, I think it's a particular skill set that are needed to come into a troubled organisation, stabilise it and turn it around quickly. And that's maybe a bit more of a narrow field at the moment. The selection panel, we hope, will ensure that we have a broader field of individuals with the right skills and experience that we can draw on.
We are subject to the market here, but I would really hope that by publicising the selection panel and hopefully working with other representative bodies and taking on board their suggestions, that we do widen the pool, because that would make it more competitive if we have a wider pool. So, I mean, we'd be very keen to do that. But at the same time, we still have to have confidence that we have the skills and expertise to deliver. So I share your views about the potential benefits of widening the pool, but just given caveats around making sure that they're going to do a good job for tenants.
I very much hope that next time we meet, that you're able to report a kind of good news story here and some improvement. Thank you, convener.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Alex.
Thank you, convener. Going back to the Scottish Social Housing Charter, I wanted to ask a few questions about the information you're getting. First of all, what did the first analysis of all charter data show you about landlords' achievements in relation to the charter, and how does it compare with the most recent charter returns?
I think very favourably. I think we have satisfaction rates from tenants of 88%. Which I think is enormously good in terms of the services that are being delivered across Scotland. I think we've done a huge piece of work from our staff, who are very expert on this now. I think we're finding that RSLs and local authorities find it easy to deal with us, find it easy to input the information. What's the biggest impact? What are we most pleased about? I think tenants say that the fact that they're kept informed by their landlord, much more so now than before, that they're engaged with, that the quality of homes is good, very important to have safe, secure neighbourhoods, very important to have warm, well-insulated homes. I think good neighbourhood management has come out very clearly as something that is tenants are satisfied with. I think, again, just other opportunities to participate for tenants. And we're finding that tenants are very much using the information to go back to the landlord and say, you know, you're doing well in this area, but maybe you could be doing better in another area. They're using it to check the information with their peers. Our comparison tool allows tenants to go in and choose other organisations and see how their landlord is performing and benchmarking. What we've seen is modest improvements this year across the board. And those that were the worst performing are actually making the best improvements, so that's really good. We will be doing, Mr. Johnston, we will be doing an analysis which we'll be publishing in January, and that's the event that I've invited you all to talk about the charter and our latest analysis of what it's doing. But we think it's doing the job that government wanted it to do. There will be a review of it, I think it's 2017, to evaluate its effectiveness and to look at other areas that we might look at, because we're keen to look at areas like value for money in terms of what does the charter tell us about value for money, and are there any other indicators around that that would be helpful for the customers of social housing. So I think it's been a great piece of work. It's been a huge piece of work for our organisation, but really good in terms of the information and the power that it's given tenants and others.
You said about the positive feedback from tenants, but particularly, have you had any feedback from landlords, tenants or service users about the usefulness of the annual charter reports themselves?
Very much. We're very keen to take on board all our stakeholders in terms of what's this giving you? And we get landlords saying it's really good because we're able to be consistent in our approach, we're able to benchmark the information, and we're able to use it to drive standards up further. So that's really good. We've had very good feedback from the forum, from SFHA, about what it's doing. Very good feedback from tenant organisations in terms of how they use it, how they communicate now with their landlord, how emboldened they feel about asking their landlord some difficult questions, but with that information and evidence behind them. So I think that's really good.
Have the reports informed you about any areas where you think there's further improvement needed?
Yes, they do, and they highlight areas around quality standards, around fuel poverty. There are areas there, I think, that we can take on board. We also, in terms of looking at the information, we check it against the information we get from the tenant panel. We have a superb tenant panel now with over 400 people on it, and they feedback in terms of what's important, and very much highlighting quality repair service, the speed of maintenance, these areas. So each individual landlord is able to assess its own particular charter data and look at areas for improvement.
The final thing I wanted to ask is, how has the information in the charter reports been used to develop the risk assessment of RSLs and local authorities?
Very much, it's a really key area of our business and our risk assessment. What we do basically is take financial health, which is absolutely critical, making sure that all RSLs are well run and actually are financially healthy. The second area we look at is governance, because it's so important in terms of having effective boards, effective governance in these organisations. But we use the charter as a really key input into that, to make sure that the information we're getting is aligned, to make sure that we're looking at risks, we're looking at how the sector is managing risk, mitigating risk. So it's a very key component. And I think it will grow. And we've said in this year's corporate plan that we will look at how we can get more information from the charter, because it's so important. It's fantastic data.
Thank you.
Blair.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning.
Good morning.
I've got a few areas, different areas to ask on. But the first one's around the affordable rents. And you have called for landlords to consider how to keep tenants' rents affordable. And I just wonder if you could comment on the response to that and how you think things might develop in the future.
Yes, and we're very conscious that for most tenants, their incomes fell quite dramatically during the economic downturn, as was the case in across the board. And while there have been some indications of improvements in that regard, I think it's almost certainly the case that for most families it will take some time to get back to the kind of levels that incomes were at before the crash. And of course we're only too aware of the challenges that are faced by those who depend on benefits. So rents being set in a way that helps tenants to keep paying their rent over the longer term is increasingly important. It's a hugely complex area. There are many factors that have to be taken into account in terms of determining rent levels and determining affordability of rent. Not all landlords are starting from the same position. Some will have a level of headroom that in their rents that would enable them to increase and remain affordable. There's no national rent policy in Scotland. And of course, tenants could make decisions with their landlord that increase rents to ensure that there's appropriate investment in new homes and in their own homes and services. The majority of RSL's business plans do show that they will continue to rely on rent increases at above inflation, so real term rent increases. And we'll monitor this carefully for two key reasons. The first one being, what will that, the impact of that be on tenants' continued ability to pay rent? Recognising that if tenants aren't in a position to pay rent, that not only affects them as tenants, but it reduces the revenue stream into landlords. And at a time of very low inflation, that can be a challenge for landlords too. So we're very conscious that there are challenges for landlords in balancing the competing demands of maintaining rents at a level tenants can afford to pay, while having a financially healthy position that lets them deal with the risks that there are, continue to invest in services for their local communities. That's not an easy task, I think would be the first thing they would say. But we are we're absolutely calling on landlords to place tenants' ability to pay at the heart of their decisions on rents and rent setting. And also, I think, alongside that, to ensure that they rigorously pursue cost control and the delivery and achievement of value for money. I think those two things go hand in hand.
Okay. Thank you for that. You did mention tenants who are reliant on benefits. Have you done any substantive work on how the welfare reforms going through Westminster at the moment might impact on housing associations in particular?
We did a significant piece of work in the first year of the first set of major changes, and we did see some changes in arrears levels that landlords were experiencing. I think to a large degree those were then mitigated by the Scottish Government's approach to the use of discretionary housing payments. Now, I think it's still quite early to see the potential impacts of some of the other changes. We are aware that some of the impacts of the sanctions regime, that's coming through from some landlords about the challenges that's presenting for individual tenants. And we're very conscious that the rollout of universal credit will present a range of issues for landlords to manage. But I would say at this point, it's probably too early to say that there has been a definite impact of the changes that have already been brought in.
Okay. If I could move on to the area of significant performance failures in the report. There were six significant performance failures reported to you in 2014-15. And I just wonder if you could give us an indication of the outcomes of these reports and how the lessons learned and the process will be used to the benefit of tenants and service users in the future.
Absolutely. As you say, during 2014-15, we had six reports made to us by tenants who had concerns that there were significant performance failures. The first thing we do is assess whether they actually do come into the category of a significant performance failure. And of those six, we found that two were indeed significant performance failures. We've during the course of this year, since April, we've had a further one report which we found to be a significant performance failure. For those situations where we were not able to determine that they were a significant performance failure, we worked with the tenants involved to assist them to take their case to the Scottish Public Service Ombudsman, who would deal with them as a complaint in those circumstances. I should also say that last year we reviewed our fact sheet for tenants to just aid the clarity of what would constitute a significant performance failure and how they would bring that forward, and the difference between a significant performance failure and a complaint, which would be dealt with by the Ombudsman. We look to get the lessons learned out of significant performance failures disseminated as widely as we possibly can, and we publish the outcomes of those. We look to the individual landlords concerned to take forward the improvement actions that are necessary as a consequence of those, and, as I say, then communicate more broadly where there may be wider lessons to be learned.
Okay. Thank you very much. If I could move on to the final area, and it was something, Ms. Blair, that you mentioned in your opening remarks about the thematic inquiries, and I just wonder if you could expand on the inquiry into gypsy travellers and just let us know how the findings of that are being taken forward.
Absolutely. Thematic inquiries are a really key piece of our work, where we're able to take a subject and actually really drill down into it. So very important, again, into feeding into our risk assessment. It was very important that we made contact with gypsy travellers. I'm pleased to say that on our tenant panel, we have over 40 gypsy travellers. And that's really, they are quite a difficult, I'm sure you know, client group to get hold of sometimes, so we're really quite proud of that. Gypsy Travellers thematic was really good in terms of highlighting where there were serious weaknesses in terms of the sites, in terms of repairs, in terms of the standards. So we made various recommendations which have been endorsed by the Housing Minister, looking at structured rent policy setting, looking at good standards, and really looking at understanding the particular needs of Gypsy Travellers. So I think that we reported, as I said, to one of your other committees on this very important piece of work, and we will obviously make sure that the recommendations are going to be implemented. So keep an eye on that. But maybe I could just talk about some of the other thematics that we're looking at.
Yes,
again,
certainly. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Very much driven by tenant feedback in terms of where they would like us to concentrate. So we're looking at one to look at how open and accessible landlords really are. You know, are they really engaging well with their tenants? Are they listening to them? We're looking at rent consultations. How do they do this? How involved are the tenants in this? We're looking at customer standards. How can these be improved? We're looking at complaints policies. How are they operated within the organisations? Are they delivering? We're looking at gas safety, again, an area that we're very keen to explore. Equalities, again, another one. And factoring, because obviously factored owners are key in terms of service users. So we're drilling down into all of these. I have to say I'm very proud of this programme because we don't have that many people and we don't have that big a budget. And I actually think we do quite a lot in terms of this added value work, which is incredibly important to our regulatory risk assessments.
Thank you. That's very welcome. Very interested to hear about the gas safety in particular, given we've just had Carbon Monoxide Awareness Week noted by the Parliament. If I could just go back to the Gypsy Travellers for a moment. In speaking to DWP staff during my other committee work in the Welfare Reform Committee, the DWP haven't included any Gypsy Travellers in the Universal Credit pilot rollouts because they consider them to be homeless. And I just wondered if that was something you would agree with in terms of their regard as being homeless in that respect.
I've not heard them referred to in that way. It's certainly not a way that we would describe Gypsy Travellers. I'm not aware of it as a way that they would be generally referred to, certainly by the providers of services to Gypsy Travellers. We're very clear that they have, they have a lifestyle which is specific to them. I don't think it fits the normal definitions of homelessness that are set out in statute. It's not a term we would use in that regard.
Good caveat by saying that was in discussion with them as to what types of groups were actually included in the universal credit. So that was what was told to me. It may not be the situation, but I would have been concerned if that had been the case that they were considered that area. So thank you very much. I'll leave it there, convener.
Thank you. Are there any other thematic inquiries planned by you?
Not at the moment. I mean, I think we've got quite a big programme already in terms of looking at the ones that I've just listed. So we will work through these. But obviously, if something comes up during the course of the year, we will look at that.
Yeah, we will use the annual risk assessment and the analysis of the charter to identify areas that might suit a thematic inquiry, and we'd also engage with our various stakeholders, particularly the different tenant groups that we engage with, to test with them whether that analysis would fit with their own priorities of areas that could benefit from the kind of in-depth scrutiny that we're able to do. So that programme will evolve over time in response to issues that emerge.
You, Adam.
Thank you, convener. Now, can I ask about regulation plans? The annual report notes that regulation plans were published for around 40% of all RSLs, which seems to be a really high number, a relatively high proportion. Is that as a consequence of your intention to work your way around all RSLs? If not, you know, why is this number so big?
Firstly, I would say that I'm not necessarily sure I would share the assessment that it's a large number. We don't engage beyond normal routine regulatory submissions with around about 2/3 of all landlords. So we concentrate our regulatory attention where it's needed. The outcome of the annual risk assessment is what determines how many regulation plans we'll have. So it's not an exercise in a cycle of engagements with each landlord. That's not how we operate. We look on every year at the information and intelligence we gather in, determine the risks that each landlord may face, and engage with them in response to those risks. So that's very much what drives the level of engagement and the number of regulation plans that we have.
Yeah, but 40% is quite a high number in terms of the numbers of RSLs that you require them to, that you require to publish regulation plans for. Would you not accept that?
Well, I think there's a number of factors that need to be borne in mind when you look at the number and levels. The first one is that this is in response to risk, and I think we would all agree that the operating context for RSLs is probably more challenging than it has ever been, and therefore that necessitates us to get an appropriate level of assurance from a number of landlords, because the risk environment has changed. Should also say that having a regulation plan is not in itself an assessment of performance. So, for example, we will engage, we will have a regulation plan with some of the best performing organisations, but because they are systemically important, they have large development programmes, a significant level of borrowing, or a number of other reasons that might necessitate them to run, for us to run a wee bit closer to them so that we properly understand their business model and can understand the risks that might be there. So that's another factor to bear in mind. Given all of that, I would say that the level of engagement we have is appropriate.
So would you anticipate that the numbers of these regulation plans to be reducing over time, given the fact that you're now much more knowledgeable about each individual RSL and their circumstances, or not?
I think that will depend on the risks. As I say, we are a risk-based regulator, so we will assess the risk. If there are new or increasing risks, then there is the potential that we'll have to have higher levels of engagement with landlords. But equally, if the environment becomes less risky or more benign, then absolutely I would expect to see a reduction in the level of regulation plans, very much driven by that risk assessment.
So what's your judgment or what's your forecast for the forthcoming year then?
Well, I think there are still a significant number of risks in the environment. We've set those out in a publication that we put into the public domain last month. The range of risks that we feel are still relevant. Some of those may increase, some may decrease over time, and what we do through the course of the year is, as we engage with landlords, we may very well change our engagement level in response to both changing risk, also in response to the assurance that we can get from individual landlords. So it's not a static thing. At the moment, I would say I don't see immediate prospects for a significant reduction in the risk levels in the RSL sector. So I wouldn't necessarily anticipate any dramatic change in the annual risk assessment that we're now undertaking. But we'll do that in a very kind of agile way to ensure that should there be any significant changes in that risk environment, we can respond to that.
And I would just add, I think it's very difficult to put a number at this stage, because as Michael has said, it's very much to do with our very comprehensive risk analysis. And I think there are lots of increasing risks around pension funding, around technical issues such as FRS 102. So there are lots of issues that are coming. There's more complexity in the sector, and we have to be absolutely on top of that to make sure that tenants' assets and tenants' interests are protected. And that is our sole statutory objective. So, I mean, I would love to be able to sit here and say, oh, next year we'll only have 20 because the risks have subsided. I don't think that will be the case. We're in a very difficult economic environment. And we're very keen in these regulation plans to work with RSLs, to be agile and to lower or heighten the criteria as we see fit at the time.
Mike, do you have a short supplementary?
Yeah, just we've heard some concerns expressed from housing associations that you're unduly risk averse, and particularly with regard to innovative practices that housing associations would like to take forward, where they feel that there can be huge benefits gained, but that your risk averse approach kind of mitigates against that. How do you get that balance right?
I think that's quite disappointing again, because I think in every situation we look at the business case, we look at the innovation. There's good innovation and sometimes there's bad innovation, so you've got to make sure that what is being proposed is stable, is safe, is going to deliver good outcomes. So I think that we look on every individual case on its own merits, but we would always welcome good innovation that actually delivers for tenants. So very keen again to speak to any RSL that has this view, to discuss it with them. But I think we are just keen to make sure that the sector remains financially healthy, that it remains stable, that attracts good lending rates. So again, I hope that answers your question. Michael, anything?
I mean, I've said before, I think, and perhaps at this committee I've said it before, I think we can all agree that RSLs have been among some of the most innovative organisations operating in Scotland as social enterprises. And they've been doing that in a context where they've been regulated in one form or another for over 30 years. So you'll not be surprised to hear that I don't buy the assertion that good regulation inhibits good innovation. And I know that there are organisations out there doing incredibly innovative stuff while being effectively regulated. This is very much about us ensuring that the interests of tenants and other service users are protected and enhanced in terms of any innovation that comes forward. And we will regularly engage with landlords who are bringing forward innovative proposals and that then take those innovative proposals into practice.
Thank you. I agree with you on that.
No
further questions, Convener.
Thanks, Convener. Now, as regulator, you've had to use your statutory intervention powers in two RSLs in the last year, the Muir House Housing Association and Wellhouse Housing Association. Can you give us an update on outcomes from that process?
Can you do
that? It's probably worth saying or restating again that statutory intervention is always a last resort for us, and we'll only intervene if we can't get the necessary assurance or improvements in any other way. Both of those interventions began last December. They were on two different bases. One was in relation to governance concerns, and another was in relation to financial health concerns. You may be aware that, and Kay referenced this in her opening remarks, that we published a revised regulation plan yesterday for Muir House Housing Association, and that indicates that we have been able to end the statutory appointment of the manager. We're keeping the statutory appointees to the board on just for a bit longer to help the organisation further address a range of governance issues and improvements. But that's a good outcome. And I think that it reflects well on the governing body of Muir House, which has worked constructively with the statutory manager to address its shortcomings. And I think there's good news across both of the statutory interventions. They're successfully resolving the issues that were identified at the outset. We'll continue with the statutory appointment for a period at Wellhouse Housing Association, as there are a number of things still to work through there, but we'll look to review that in the new year. I would absolutely encourage the committee to engage directly with the two associations to understand their experience of the intervention. And we will also publish a full report on each of those two cases when the interventions have been concluded.
Okay, thank you. And do you anticipate using these powers on a regular or a frequent basis? Can you make any sort of judgment on that?
We've only ever used those powers in these two organisations in the 4 years of our existence. It's difficult to anticipate the circumstances where these will arise in terms of our current assessment of organisations. There's nothing that would necessarily immediately tell us that we have to intervene in this way in other organisations. It would very much be in response to specific risks and issues that, as they arose, that we would make use of these powers.
Obviously, the role of the regulator is to safeguard and promote the interests of tenants, and you've said that on a number of occasions. Can you, just in order to aid the committee's understanding of the statutory intervention powers that have been invoked in the case of these two housing associations, what do you think the consequences would have been for tenants had you not intervened in this way?
I think the consequences would have been different in each of the individual organisations, because, as I said, there were very different things. But ultimately, I think it was very clear to us that tenants' interests were at risk. In one of them, there was a very serious risk of insolvency, which obviously would have very immediately put tenants' security of tenure at risk. And that was why we felt it appropriate to move quickly to intervene in that one with these very significant powers being used. In the other organisation, again, the concern was that the range of governance and management weaknesses were such that if they weren't addressed and addressed quickly, they would then very quickly start to impact on tenants' interests and on the broader reputation of the RSL sector.
Okay, thank you. Adam?
Yeah, my final question is really on the revised regulatory guidance that you've developed. Can you provide further details on that? And in particular, could you comment on how it addresses the issue of proportionality, which had been a concern for stakeholders?
Absolutely. Again, we took a great deal of time to engage with stakeholders around this, to get feedback about what would be helpful, where we could clarify issues, where we could give greater understanding and information. At the end of this, in August, we produced revised regulatory guidance, and it's streamlined a lot of the information requirements. It's made it a lot clearer. And we've had strong endorsement from the sector about how useful this now is. So clearly what we're doing now is looking to see how implementation goes on this. As I said often, I'm really keen that wherever we can, we streamline what we do, we make it easier for landlords to use and understand the information. So I think it's been a good step forward, and I think it's been welcomed by the sector, but obviously, again, we'll keep an eye on it to look if there are any further improvements. But I think it's been a good initiative.
Okay. And have you had feedback from stakeholders?
Very much so, very much so, and very positive feedback about how it's working. And I think that's a reflection, again, of how much we engaged with people before we produced this to make sure that it was actually what was needed and required, but also met our requirements as well.
Okay.
Thank you. Dave?
Thank you, Convener. I've got a whole series of questions around finance. And my general question is, how would you assess the financial health of RSLs?
I think the financial health is good. I think that there are healthy surpluses. I think they're in a strong cash position. So I think in terms of the lending community, the social housing sector is viewed very positively. I think there is lots of input from the lending community. They're very keen to get involved. They're very keen, again, to look at our regulatory judgments and guidance and use that as confidence and comfort. So I talked about the work that we'd followed up in terms of looking at how much was actually saved in the sector because of good regulation. But it's not just about monetary value. It's about how the social housing sector is viewed in Scotland, how important it is. So I think in terms of financial health, it's a good story to tell, and long may that remain.
Can I raise the issue then of threats? Clearly, it's good to hear there's a very positive story. I think Michael mentioned earlier there was one case, there was a risk of insolvency. I don't know if you're able to talk about any of the details of that, or in general, if you can't, in general, how would a housing association end up being in a position that it effectively could go bust?
I think those, in our experience, and we've had to manage a number of organisations that have got close to real financial difficulty, it tends not to be necessarily the wider environment that creates the problems. It tends to be decision making within the organisation itself. Poor decision making without the appropriate governance oversight has tended to take them to a place where it puts their finances in jeopardy. That's been a significant finding from a range of the governance matters publications we've put out, that it tends to be specifics to the organisation.
So it would be sort of chronic poor management, weakness in boards, lack of leadership by chief executive, factors?
It can be all these factors, or a lack of appreciation of what they might be getting into, a lack of experience in managing new ventures, new initiatives that mean that they put the organisation at risk, often without being aware that that's what they are doing. So it tends to be these organisational specific issues that have resulted in financial challenges rather than more global ones. We are seeing more challenges coming from that area. Kay mentioned earlier the introduction of Financial Reporting Standard 102, which has the potential to significantly change the reported financial position of a number of landlords. Pension liabilities and deficits are something which we've been concerned about for a number of years, although we're starting to hear some encouraging noises in that regard. The type of challenges that will come to landlords through welfare reform and the changes that are coming there, these are more systemic challenges that are presenting all the landlords and that they need to have a very clear eye to in terms of managing their ongoing financial health.
Even the strongest organisations can have problems with pensions. Many large organisations have got massive pension deficits, and that's not necessarily because it's poorly managed, that's just the nature of the beast.
That's often a legacy issue of a pension scheme that has been initiated a number of years previously. What's critical is how they then go on and manage that situation, manage the liabilities and look to limit future liabilities.
Can I look at then other threats? In the private sector, obviously there's always a concern about interest rates, and clearly, you would probably need to be the brand seer to work out what the interest rate is going to be next year. The Bank of England have talked about a rise for some time, and as you know, it's stayed fairly stable. Would a dramatic change in interest rates be a shock to the sector, in the sense, both in the emotional sense of the word, but also in terms of the effect on the balance sheet?
It would be. Landlords at the moment are enjoying historically low interest rates, and many of them guard those interest rates very dearly for obvious reasons, and that's why it's critically important that landlords ensure that they have a good relationship with their lender, that they're managing their lending covenants effectively. But yes, a significant increase in interest rates would have a dramatic impact on the surplus position that Kay mentioned. That's something which we encourage landlords to look at in terms of their financial planning and their business planning, to run scenarios, to stress test their business plans to ensure that they understand what type of change in that environment would lead to difficulties for them, and therefore that they can start to put in place actions to mitigate the impact of any such kind of systemic shock.
And the other issue I wanted to raise, and I was very interested to read about the new proposals that's going ahead with the Wheatley Housing Group, the 250 million AA-rated public listed bond. I mean, that's very interesting. But could you just go through these sort of various decision-making chains on this? And as you know, I mean, Scottish Government itself only had marginal powers of finance until the Smith Commission proposals, but this is a real change. Firstly, I noticed that it said that your organisation approved this. I mean, presumably Scottish Government itself had a decision-making role as well. And if that is the case, I mean, what potential is there for every housing association getting this type of bond? I mean, this is a fantastic opportunity to increase the supply of affordable housing.
Yes, Wheatley Housing issued a bond to the tune of 250 million. They then went fairly quickly for a further tap of 50 million quite quickly after that. So currently have an unnamed bond to the value of 300 million pounds. Scottish Government, as I understand it, supported Wheatley in this endeavour, and part of the package that related to the bond also involved a level of grant funding from Scottish Government. Our role in this is twofold. Firstly, we met with the relevant ratings agencies that are instrumental in ensuring that an organisation is in a position to go to the capital markets. We met with them to help them understand our approach to regulation and what that would mean in terms of confidence that investors can take in the role that we have with Wheatley Housing Group and other social landlords in Scotland. The approvals or the consent which we are then involved in is the consent that's required to dispose of assets by standard security involved in any lending, and that followed a full consideration of the business case that was presented to us by Wheatley Housing Group. In terms of capacity to use this as a model more widely, I think there are substantial costs and significant preparation involved in going to market for an unnamed bond. And that may mean that it could only be the larger organisations that are in a position to do that. And it may not be practical for smaller organisations to take that particular road.
Just to interrupt, sorry, at that stage, Sir Cameron, in very crude terms, where would you say the cut-off point is then in terms of what would the minimum turnover or scale of a housing association be in order to be eligible effectively for this bond funding?
I don't think there's a particular number that you would put on that because it would depend on a number of things. And one of the things I was going to say is there are some other routes that landlords can take. So, for example, last year, Link Group had a private placement for £45 million, and that for them was a more appropriate and manageable approach to take. There are a number of bond aggregators operating in Scotland, the Housing Finance Corporation, GB Social Housing, that enable smaller organisations to access capital markets through those aggregators. So there are a number of different routes and options open. And it's also worth saying that we're continuing to see a relatively healthy market in the traditional lending arena. So there are options open to social landlords.
The other issue was raised, I started this questions about, and when I mentioned threats and risks, is there any greater risks going down this route?
There may be different risks. I mean, one of the challenges is around treasury management and a bond where you have multiple investors rather than you engaging directly with one lender and having a clear relationship. So there can be treasury management challenges. A bond also results in you getting that lump sum early on, and you then need to manage that effectively. Traditional lending, you draw the money down when and as you need it. So there are a number of different challenges and risks in this model, but whether they're necessarily greater, I think that's...
Yeah. I suppose it goes back to the earlier point about how strong your board is and how strong your chief exec. I mean, if this is more complex and you've got a weaker organisation, then that might impact on it. The other thing I was going to say, I don't have time, convener, to talk about the wider economic issues, because you were mentioning, of course, it's AA rated. I was going to make the perhaps larger point that Lehman Brothers in America had AAA rated collateralized bond obligations, and that started the world economic crisis. So it's like, who guards the guards in terms of credit agencies? So I would make that general point to be a bit careful about how we treat AAA or AA rated bonds, but that's perhaps another point for another day.
Can I just ask, on the, you said that there was a significant level of cost attached to going down this route for the larger RSLs. That's what you, am I right?
Yeah.
In saying that, do you have any indication of what the ratio of those costs to the amount being secured through loans would be?
I don't have that information, but I can see if I can obtain that for the committee.
That would be helpful.
The committee makes a very useful point. So clearly, you need to be careful on the contingency funding that you had if you're going down this particular route. I'm going to touch later on the ONS classifications, which I know is a bit techie, but I think it's important to get this clear. So this 250 million, which I think you said raises to 350 million, does this technically count against Scottish Government capital spending?
No.
So is this entirely separate?
Yes.
Right. Okay, that's useful to know. The Council of Mortgage Lenders has highlighted high levels of investor compliance, confidence in the social housing sector, and its support for the level of regulation carried out by your organisation. Does that correspond with what you were seeing across the sector?
Yes, I think confidence levels of lenders remain high in terms of Scottish landlords. And obviously it's interesting to, or it will be interesting to see whether the Scottish context becomes a more attractive investment proposition than elsewhere in the UK, given some of the very significant changes that are happening elsewhere. It could very well be that lenders would view Scotland as a more benign investment environment, notwithstanding that obviously there could be further changes in the Scottish context as well.
Could I go on to next, and I apologise, this point's a bit technical. I'm highly concerned about the Office of National Statistics classifications of housing associations. We had it in Scotland, as you may know, on the Harbours Act that went through, where large harbours were going to be classified. So that basically meant the likes of Peterhead, any spending it did, or Aberdeen, and its massive investment in NIG, we count against government spending, which is absolutely disastrous for trying to manage an economy. It's also disastrous for the harbours, I might say. In England, this is likely to happen for housing associations, which would mean that any spending in housing association would count as national debt. That would mean about 60 billion, 4% increase in national debt in England. Now, that's a massive problem if that also applies to Scotland. So it's back to my earlier point. Bond spending could well count against national debt in Scotland. What's your view on this? Is this likely to happen?
Well, what we do know is that, as you say, the Office of National Statistics has announced that housing associations in England are being reclassified as public corporations. And that means that, as you say, nearly 60 billion of debt that they have now features on the government's books as public sector debt. And the basis for that change that was set out by the ONS was that the UK government, through the Housing and Communities Agency, the English regulator, has control over associations through the regulatory powers that are invested in that agency, and particularly around consents for disposals and directing the use of proceeds from disposals, voluntary winding up, dissolution, restructuring, appointment of managers, those type of powers were seen as giving the government control over these organisations and therefore merited the reclassification. And the implications, as you say, beyond the understanding that that then places that debt onto the public book, remain quite vague in terms of the individual landlords and themselves, although there is a sense that any subsequent borrowing by those organisations may very well need to have some form of government approval because it would count towards public debt. We're aware that the Westminster government has vowed to take associations in England back out of that classification by changing the regulatory powers that are available to the HCA. To date, the ONS has given no indication of plans to do a similar review in Scotland. And there are no direct implications of this decision on Scottish RSLs at this time. So it very much depends on what the ONS plans are, and I don't have any insight into what those plans are.
Maybe this is something the committee might want to pursue. I mean, I would have thought if this is happening in England, it'll happen in Scotland. I cannot see that we've been excluded for this. As I said earlier, it applied to harbours until the Scottish Government changed legislation. And I understand it applies to lots of colleges currently in Scotland. So, you know, we're not going to be exempt from this. Clearly, if it was going to happen, there would be opportunities for government to presumably to change some of the regulatory regime in Scotland. But I don't want to get ahead of myself. But personally, I think it would be quite damaging if this did happen within Scotland. And it may affect government spending on housing associations and how housing associations are managed as well. But that's maybe something we can flag up. Yeah. Sorry.
I was just going to say I agree with you. I think it's quite worrying and concerning what's happening in England. And we as a regulator here are keeping a very close eye on this. We're also keeping a close eye on English companies, RSLs operating in Scotland, and whether there's any impact on their activities. So if I can give you assurance that, you know, we do understand your concerns and we are keeping a very active eye on this.
Thank you, Gabriel.
Okay. The SHR published its new corporate plan 2015 to 2018 in April of this year and its annual work plan in May of this year. Can you say a little bit about what the key features of the new corporate plan are?
Absolutely. Again, I think we're being very consistent in what we're looking at. So we're looking at three priorities: financial health, we've talked about good governance, and today the conversation has quite often come back to the strength and expertise and capability of boards and board decisions, and given the complexity of the sector and the increasing areas of diversity that they're getting into, we're very keen to keep an eye on that. And obviously the charter and service delivery and the information that gives us, which is incredibly important. So we want to help tenants scrutinise performance. We want to give landlords comfort in terms of benchmarking their organisations. We are very much in our corporate plan stressing the more challenging environment that we think that we're in. So again, looking at risk, for us being proportionate in our approach, being effective in our approach, and looking at issues like rent affordability and the sustainability of the sector. It's a very important sector.
That's
right. I hope that answers your question.
No, it does. Mr. Cameron, do you have anything to add to that?
The only other thing I would perhaps add to that is that in our corporate plan, we've set out a commitment to undertake a full review of the regulatory framework, kicking off in 2017, and take the approach that we took with appeals by initiating that with a discussion paper before moving into any kind of formal consultation. So opportunities to review the continued relevance and appropriateness of all our regulatory approaches, that's a commitment we've made.
Okay, thank you. Do members have any further questions? Are there any closing remarks we'd like to make?
No, just to thank you very much for the scrutiny that you give us. It's very important that we're accountable. It's very important that we can answer your questions effectively, that we can give you confidence that we are doing a good job as a regulator. I think one of the challenges for us coming up will be, as for all public bodies, is a spending review. We're very keen that we are able to maintain the resources that we have, that we're able to deliver effective regulation. We think that we add huge value in terms of what we do. So we await with some trepidation the results of the spending review, as I'm sure a lot of other bodies do.
You're not alone in that.
I hope, Convener, that we've given you assurance about our performance.
Thank you. Clearly, the Scottish Housing Regulator is in a almost unique position of being independent of government and having its lines of accountability through this committee to the Parliament. So we're very conscious of the importance of holding the regulator to account, and very much value your attendance this morning and the evidence that you've given the committee. So once again, can I thank Kay Blair and Michael Cameron for their evidence this morning. And that concludes today's committee business. I now close this meeting of the committee.